week, we're going to talk about a nonprofit called Little Brothers, Friends of the Elderly. As the name suggests, Little Brothers aims to combat and provide relief to elderly people facing isolation and loneliness, especially to those who live alone and struggle financially. Since its founding, Little Brothers has been working to improve the lives of elders in need through the offering of emotional and physical support. And here to talk more about the nonprofit is its executive director, Nikki Schultz. Nikki, thanks for joining us today.
Hi, George. Thank you so much for having us. Glad to be here.
So let me start off by saying that as a show whose listeners tune in to listen about baby boomer topics and discussion, we're glad to hear about and raise awareness on how we can help fellow baby boomers out in regards to their health and well-being, especially in these times. That brings me to the nonprofit's mission. Can you tell us the key objectives that Little Brothers aims to address, and can you explain to our listeners what those are?
Sure, happy to. So the mission of Little Brothers, Friends of the Elderly, is to relieve isolation and loneliness among the elderly. What we do in Boston is we do this through intergenerational programming that brings university students to senior housing buildings across the city for weekly social activities. The activities that we do are determined by both the older and younger participants, and it ranges anywhere from art, music, cards, games, conversation circles. We work with a lot of international students and language learners, so we're able to have some languages exchanges and programs in English, Spanish, Chinese, depending on the students that we have in, sometimes Russian, Albanian, Vietnamese. And really, the activity is less important than the relationships that are formed during these programs. We look to introduce younger and older people together who otherwise would likely not meet to build intergenerational relationships, but also for the folks living in the senior housing buildings to get to meet their neighbors and develop a social network where they live.
I really love that, just bridging the gap between the young and the old and just caring for the elderly. It's a really good cause. On that note, what has Little Brothers accomplished concerning the number of elders helped over the years and the amount of help given by volunteers in fulfilling that mission?
Sure. So we've been in Boston for 41 years, so that's a lot of lives that we've touched. We serve around 1,000 unique individuals every year over the course of 41 years. That's around 40,000 older adults, not to mention the volunteers and students that we work with. Since we've been around since 1979, our programs have changed a lot over the years. We've done holiday programs and luncheon programs and visiting. Now we do a lot more intergenerational work and tech access. We still celebrate the holidays and we do summer picnics. Not this year, but you know, usually it's really just about bringing people together and letting people know that they're not alone and that the Little Brothers in the world and we're all here for them.
I know you've changed so many lives over those last 41 years or so. Can you share with us a notable story that a particular life has been changed since Little Brothers was established? Maybe there's a few of them that really pop out.
Sure. So, George, I knew you were going to ask this question, and immediately when I considered it, I thought of my friend. I'm going to call him Robert.
Sure.
Change his name for personal reasons.
Sure.
Robert was one of the people in our programs that I really connected with personally. He was formerly homeless, and we met him when we were looking to start a program in the congregational living site that he was in. At first, he was like, oh, you can try, but it's not going to change. Nothing's going to be different, but you can try. So we're like, well, you know what, Robert? We are going to try. So we came in, and we started working with the Milestones Day Program, mm-hmm. which is this great organization, and they work with young adults on the autism spectrum, and we connected those young folks with the formerly homeless older folks living at this particular housing unit. And they came and did bingo and some games on Wednesday afternoons. And I would see Robert from time to time. He was suffering from cancer, so I would take him to some doctor's appointments. He would come over for our game days on Fridays, and we would play Scrabble, which he was a very good opponent. But one day I asked Robert if he would allow me to interview him and to talk about Little Brothers. And the interview was probably one of the most touching conversations I've had in my career. And I asked him what Little Brothers meant to him. And he talked about the students at the Milestone Day program and one young man in particular. And he was saying, oh, when I first met him, he didn't say much, really quiet, calling the numbers. But I started talking to him and I started a relationship with him. And he went off to junior college and he came back to me and he was really excited to share with Robert about where he's gone with his career and the success that he's had. And at that moment, Robert broke into tears and he was saying, I'd like to think that I had something to do with that. And Robert had a lot of demons in his life and that complicated personal relationships that he had. But through Little Brothers, he was able to find meaning and a purpose in his final years. And that was working with these students and that one young man in particular, and what a difference it made in both of their lives.
That's really nice and it's touching. Oftentimes, I don't think that people give attention to the end-of-life care and just people who are above a certain age. every moment in your life counts, even before the moment where we all die. So just having the amount of care, help, and humanization towards living longer if you can, and helping foster that life beyond that point through whatever means, meeting the right people, having the opportunities through networking, it's a really good cause.
Yeah, thank you.
So with the ongoing pandemic we're in, coronavirus, what has been the top goal for the nonprofit this year? In particular, what has been exacerbated because of the pandemic that Little Brothers could really use some extra help in? And I know that with volunteering, it's going to pose a serious risk for people who are above, I'd say, 50, 60. I mean, for all ages especially, but for the elderly in particular, it's really risky. So what are you doing right now to keep the mission alive and in a way still intact?
Yeah, you kind of hit the nail on the head. Our organization is all about creating relationships and building friendships. We're usually in person with folks every week, and we have special events and picnics and parties. I mean, our world was really turned upside down on March 13th. Mm-hmm. It's so dangerous to have in-person programs, particularly with older adults. But the dangers of isolation and loneliness are exacerbated by the pandemic, where people of all ages, you, me, everyone is feeling the pangs of loneliness and how difficult it can be. So we've really stepped up, and we felt like this is our moment. This is why Little Brothers Friends of the Elderly exists. So our immediate response is we pivoted to phone calls, and we have volunteers connected with folks in our programs, and they're calling. At the very beginning, they were making sure they were connected to the right services. The city has done a wonderful job making sure people have access to food and health care. So we're just making sure everyone knew how to access those services. And now those volunteers are still calling once or twice a week just to check in and check that someone, they've got someone to talk to. But once we realized that this was going to last more than a couple weeks and we were in it for the long haul, we have transitioned our intergenerational programs into virtual programs, which has been a challenge. A lot of the folks that we work with do not have access to devices or internet. Many of them have never been on the internet before. So we were really starting from the beginning. So through a generous donation, we did receive 100 tablets with a few months of prepaid data plans, and we were able to distribute those. And now we're back to having our weekly intergenerational programs. They just happen on Zoom, and we bring students and older folks living in senior housing buildings together for the same types of activities. And it's been really inspiring to see people that new to technology just laugh through the learning curve, and the resilience of older people is always inspiring and one of the biggest reasons why I am in this line of work, just seeing people learn something new, get outside of their comfort zone and do what it takes to make sure that their social networks and their social needs are met.
For sure. And to segue from that, the final thing I want to ask is how and where can our listeners donate to in terms of money or other forms of compensation to Little Brothers?
Thank you so much for asking. People can donate any amount to us, and the easiest way to do that is online. Our website is www.littlebrothersboston.org. That's Little Brothers, all spelled out, littlebrothersboston.org. And you can donate directly onto that page. And coming up, we have our annual gala was meant to be in September, but we've gone virtual. So on our website, you'll also see information that talks about we're releasing 5 episodes from August 26th to September 23rd on Wednesdays. We're really excited. We have special guests. We've got Governor Baker will be with us, Sandra Harris from Mass AARP, and musical performances by the Indigo Girls, Yo-Yo Ma, and Livingston Taylor, among others. So that's a really great way to learn more about our organization as time goes on. But at the moment, donations through littlebrothersboston.org is greatly appreciated, so we can continue getting people connected and renewing data plans and bring in students to these weekly intergenerational virtual programs.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Nikki, for your time this week, and all the best to you.
All right, thank you so much for having us and letting us talk about this organization that I love so much. How'd you learn of us? Just curious.
Well, I'm trying to look for nonprofits, honestly. We're trying to be philanthropic in a way. It's just trying to help any cause at this point. We're a baby boomer show, so it doesn't have to be baby boomer related. But in your case, I jumped at the chance because just to help fellow boomers out, I'm not a boomer myself, obviously, but the generational gap you were talking about before, that's kind of the theme or motif I'm myself in right now with the radio show, because I'm a millennial, but I also help on behalf of boomers just to give out content. I'm not the host of the show, but I do help in the production side of things. So, you know, that to me was what resonated, and that's why I wanted to have you guys on especially.
I'm so glad to hear that. I love when fellow millennials actually respect in boomers. Like the OK Boomer meme breaks my heart.
I don't like it. I think memes in general, they do put off some people, but that especially, it's just like a pivot or insult kind of. It's just not good.
Yeah, and every time I see a friend posting something like that, I'm that person. It's like, you shouldn't say that. That's not nice.
It is not nice, no. But we're trying to do the opposite of that. And our listeners, people who are young, you know, I'm hoping that for the show we do, it does break, not to say break barriers, but it just helps to break down that definition, okay, boomer, down to, okay, it is insulting in a way. There is enough respect out there from TV shows, from the music from that era. Without that stuff, there wouldn't be music or TV or film built on that foundation from way back when, today. So there needs to be some acknowledgement there and some respect, you know?
Mm-hmm.
For sure.
Even in I know you're South Shore, but like a city like Boston, you know, the boomers really made this city what it is today.
Oh, I know. I do my research and I do my reading and I've talked to people of that age range and you can't ignore that and you can't disrespect that. Well, I don't want to take up too much of your time. I just thank you again for being on this. Take care, Nikki. Thanks.
All right, really nice meeting you, George. Take care. Thank you.
No problem. Bye.